We'll be right back. They are the real humans. We are manufactured. We are a source of life they need for survival. They. Who is they? They are the real humans. They live for hundreds of years. Our blood is a product. Our blood is currency. Our blood is their food. Death has the word eat in it. Time zones keep one half of the population rested while the other half is alive and awake. We are sent to work all week to be weakened. We are meant to recover. They don't want us dead. We are nurtured while we are harvested. Who are they? They are the real humans. We are the host. Us alive. Food is a hoax. We don't need it. Sleep is a hoax. We don't need it. Who is they? They are the real humans. They are the ones harvesting this manufactured breed, keeping us in line, always maintained and managed. They are the real humans. They are vampires. Truth is, death is a hoax, maybe the biggest hoax of them all. Death of this body is what we should do the second we are born. We are a fake breed of human. The real humans have us believing that we should fear death in the churches and legally. Suicide is a crime. Why? Because we are a product. Owned. We do not have say over our own death. Why? Because in the churches it's a sin, and in the courtroom it's a law that's being broken, and we are livestock. We are to suffer a long, hard life, and usually a long, hard illness at death. That's to ensure our soul/IPUs fully deleted. It's shutdown/death to be refurbished for another host. Our blood has been engineered and manufactured. The real blood hosts are the one in power. Who are they? The real humans. Our breed is a life source for them. Just like the movie Monsters, Inc., we are uploaded while we are in the womb and docked by the doctor at birth, injected with a syrup that blocks the upload from the source of life, leaving us to be a blank memory card to fill up with their intent. We are designed to be kept at a minimum and a maximum output at all times for harvesting our IPU systems within us. They make us fear death because they need us alive. Death is the only way out, not a natural death. Natural death brings you back. Only suicide stops the loop.
We live in this structure, this designed farming system where we're herded around during the week time. You know, they want us to recover, you know, they give us the weekend to recover. The parasites never want to kill their host. They'll bring them right up to it, but they won't kill them. So they tell us what they're doing to us as they do it. We live in the week. That's the time that we're being harvested, and then they give us the weekend, a little yard time, because we've been weakened. They need us to recover. So go eat the food we want you to eat. Put all that stuff into your bloodstream for us. And they separate us in these time zones. So there's always a fresh supply. We live on a farm. They get into us also through our Wi-Fi and our routers. If you unplug your router, you will get phone calls from your carrier. They do not want that thing unplugged. It's another way they get into you. They get into you when you're sleeping. That's what dreams are.
Hey, may the best monster win.
I plan to.
We are on in 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2.
Get a boss, get a boss, get a big hairy boss.
Coming right up. You're behind, Randall. You know, maybe I should realign the screen and take
Just get me another door!
Ah, the door, yes, door!
Well, Jerry, what's the damage so far?
We may actually make our quota today, sir.
First time in a month.
High-volume, high-quality blood testing machine is unique to the blood banking world. Fully automated, it helps ensure the safety of the blood supply by testing donor samples for things like hepatitis B, C, and HIV. In 8 hours, it runs 5 different blood tests on 1,000 donations without human intervention. Between each of these tests, it sterilizes every single probe in a wash solution. Another machine determines the blood type, of which there are 8. They scan the donor's collection bag and document what products they will produce from the blood. Then they weigh it. Overnight, gravity causes the blood to separate into its 3 components, so a worker remixes it, preparing it for machine separation. She then packs the blood in the bags for the other components into what's called a liner. She makes sure the liners are balanced and will put a rubber weight inside when she needs to. Balancing the liners keeps the centrifuge machine spinning properly at 4,000 RPM as it separates the blood into layers. She then hooks up the unit of separated blood to an automated extractor and once again matches the unit with the donor.
Seemingly easy question. But at any given moment, the time will be different in different places in the world. While one person is waking up to breakfast at 7 a.m., another will be heading off to bed at 10 p.m. Local time all depends on what time zone you're in. A time zone is simply a region on Earth which is bound by longitudinal lines. These lines, sometimes called meridians, run vertically from the north to the south pole, each 15 degrees apart. Meridians break the world into 24 time zones.
Thank you. really happy to be here because I love Montreal. It's like Paris, but you bathe. And it is just so nice to be here. I can't get down the stairs.
You guys have a good dinner tonight?
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go.
Can I help you here?
It's very deep. And I worked in that coffee shop as a waitress to pay to go to all the comedy. And and you were very generous because I found out if you limp, Montrealians give you extra tips. Oh.
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go. Can I help you here?
Now, as I promised, we'll talk now more about David Bowie and his influence. Let's bring in Jack Stephen. He is director of Fortune Music.
It's actually Fortress Music.
Fortress Music. Yeah. Do beg your pardon, Jack. Fortress Music, and worked as a music industry as an executive in the Bowie era, and also Bowie's fashion sense we're going to talk about as well. It's influenced the era. And Lizzie Zita, fashion stylist, is with. Welcome to you both. Apologies again, Jack.
No problem.
I mean, but perhaps first sum up how you felt this morning when you heard this.
I was just saying earlier that I actually felt that part of me had died. I mean, I have to say that's how much an influence he is, I think, to me and to thousands and millions of people around the world. And strangely, I'm surprised. I sort of lived through John Lennon's death, Elvis's death, and sadly, this one's affected me more than any other. I mean, it's a very strange thing because I think with him, he was probably the first complete artist where he was involved in every single area of his career, whether it's photography, fashion, whether it was film, whether it was poetry, whether it was live work where he was very theatrical. His vocal influence, a lot of people don't know this, came from Anthony Newley, who of course was a musical artist. I find it very, very sad today.
Just finally then, Jack, Black Star. I mean, right. Do you see it how people are seeing it today, that this is his goodbye,
I think it is his goodbye, but I don't think he'll ever be forgotten.
of the era.
Meet Allie. At 15, she has it all.
Like when your head was cast.
Hollywood special effects makeup master Tony Gardner, who has done such films as Three Kings, There's Something About Mary, and Shallow Hal, and put Allie in a fat suit. Course of 3 hours, she was layered with latex, spray painted with makeup, and heavily padded.
As soon as I found out John C. Reilly was playing Hardy and Steve Coogan was playing Laurel, I couldn't actually think of anybody better, any pair that would be better than those two.
For the time we were shooting this film, this area right here was exposed and this area on my flats of my hands. That's it. The rest of my body was encased in prosthetics or a fat suit. It was like wearing a mask on your whole body. And that mask was so convincing that it made me believe, sort of from the outside in, that I could play the character.
This is one of the fat suits. It's made in two sections, so we've got trousers and a top, which pull on separately and zip together. And under here, we've got little weighted bags, lead shot, basically, because John wanted to feel some weight built into the suit, so it actually felt heavy to him.
It really affected the way he walked. It did make him move in a different way.
Well, I tell you, they changed that drunk driving shit, man. The attitude is just too harsh for me. Way too harsh. You remember 10 years ago? Anybody 10 years ago? You got pulled over. Cop came up to your car. Son, you been drinking? Yeah. Oh, sorry to bother you.
If I'm in a cafeteria, because I like going to blue-collar places, like Luby's, and I see old ladies in there that are scrimping and can't buy food, I don't like to make a big deal of it. I go up to the front and pay for their food. And then I start crying because 10 years ago, people were able to buy themselves food.
Well, I tell you, they changed that drunk driving shit, man. The attitude is just too harsh for me. Way too harsh. You remember 10 years ago? Anybody 10 years ago? You got pulled over. Cop came up to your car. Son, you been drinking? Yeah. Oh, sorry to bother you.
If I'm in a cafeteria, because I like going to blue-collar places, like Luby's, and I see old ladies in there that are scrimping and can't buy food, I don't like to make a big deal of it. I go up to the front and pay for their food, and then I start crying because 10 years ago, people were able to buy themselves food.
We're going to be showing you a close-up of that. That is Forest Lawn. Were you surprised, Dave, to hear from him when you were 7?
Oh, it's a very interesting story, Larry. It was kind of, the visit to his Encino house was very impromptu, and it was kept a secret by my mother. And I had always been kind of a admirer of his, not a fan per se, but I always loved his music. And my mother surprised me one day and brought me up to Neverland. And I entered an arcade, and there were all these Paul McCartney records all over this, The Girl Is Mine, and, you know, this and that. And I remember sitting down, and at the time, my favorite video games, my favorite video game was Pole Position. And I was playing Pole Position, and I felt a little tap on my shoulder, and I turned around, and there was Michael. And you know what, Larry?
What?
At that moment, we embraced.
More than we
but
are
I've never had my cheekbones done, never had my eyes done, never had all that my lips done and all this stuff. They just go too far. I mean, it's crazy. But this is something that happens like every day with other people.
Are you pleased now with the way you the way
I'm
you
never
look?
Pleased with anything. I'm a perfectionist.
Yeah.
It's part of who I am.
And
meet Allie. At 15, she has it all.
Like when your head was cast.
Hollywood special effects makeup master Tony Gardner, who has done such films as Three Kings, There's Something About Mary, and Shallow Hal, and put Allie in a fat suit. In the course of 3 hours, she was layered with latex, spray painted with makeup, and heavily padded.
And as soon as I found out John C. Reilly was playing Hardy and Steve Coogan was playing Laurel, I couldn't actually think of anybody better, any pair that would be better than those two.
For the time we were shooting this film, this area right here was exposed and this area on my flats of my hands. That's it. The rest of my body was encased in prosthetics or a fat suit. It was like wearing a mask on your whole body. And that mask was so convincing that it made me believe, sort of from the outside in, that I could play the character.
This is one of the fat suits. It's made in two sections, so we've got trousers and a top, which pull on separately and zip together. And under here, we've got little weighted bags, lead shot, basically, because John wanted to feel some weight built into the suit, so it actually felt heavy to him.
It really affected the way he walked. It did make him move in a different way.
What do we have here, Ken? Let's see. Oh, it's an indictment, all right. Why don't you read it to me? You're on for election, aren't you?
Mr. Bundy?
You got it, didn't you?
Mr. Bundy?
You told me that you were going to get me. He said he was going to get me, okay? You've got the indictment. It's all you're going to get. Let's read it. Let's go.
Theodore Robert Bundy, you are charged, indictment, 2 counts burglary, 2 counts murder in the first degree, 3 counts attempted murder in the first degree. Design or intent to effect the death of said Lisa Levy.
My chance to talk to the press.
Contrary to section 78204 Florida statute.
I'll plead not guilty right now.
And your grand jury is being present.
A judge in Miami today followed the jury's recommendation and sentenced Theodore Bundy to die in the electric chair for the murder of two co-eds. Bundy is the 136th person under death sentence in Florida. Ed Rabel reports.
Before pronouncing the sentence, Judge Edward Cowart let Bundy make a statement.
I'm not asking for mercy. For I find it somewhat absurd to ask for mercy for something I did not do. So I will be tortured for and will suffer for and receive the pain for that act. But I will not share the burden for the guilt.
In imposing sentence, Judge Cowart cited the savagery of the crimes and what he called the indifference of the defendant.
This court, independent of, but in agreement with, the advisory sentence rendered by the jury, does hereby impose the death penalty upon the defendant Theodore Robert Bundy.
Then, in an unexpected move, perhaps an afterthought, Cowart stunned the courtroom with some parting words for Bundy.
Take care of yourself, young man.
Thank you.
I say that to you sincerely. Take care of yourself. It's a tragedy for this court to see. It's such a total waste, I think, of humanity that I've experienced in this court. You're a bright young man. You made a good lawyer. I'd love to have you practice in front of me, but you went another way, partner.
Bundy says he'll appeal. Meanwhile, he has been ordered to the state prison to await setting of the date of his execution in the electric chair. Ed Brabel, CBS News, Miami.
This is the field where they staged the Kent State fake shootings. It's a little memorial for it. A little mockery. Yeah, I mean, if you really examine all the pictures, first of all the pictures are in black and white. It was the 1970s. I mean, we had color film. So, everything's in black and white. Just an easier way to hide detail. They didn't have to fake blood colors and stuff like that. They could not worry about how it's going to look on film if it's all in black and white. And it's just a couple of the same photos over and over again. You could tell it's staged. It looks just like the ones they do today. This happened all during Vietnam War time. So yeah. I live pretty close to Kent. Kent State University, and a little bummed because there's actually a visitor center that I was hoping to get into, but they're closed. Yeah, the day before, I'm here on May 3rd, so May 4th is the day of the staged event. And they're closed? Yeah. Interesting. Examine that a little later. So they have this little tour you can take. And here's one more, Law and Order and Descent. It's just talking about bearing rifles. They say that students didn't know the rifles were loaded. Right, because it was a staged event and everybody involved knew that there were no real bullets being used. So when four went down, not everybody's in on this, you know? I mean, there's some sort of drill going on or something like that. I mean, why is the National Guard there to begin with? They say they came in because of the protests, but that's a lot of National Guard just to show up out of nowhere because there's some students pissed off, you know. So it was all staged, just like they do today. But right here it says Company C moved towards, you know, the area. Company C, so you got C, C, which is the third letter in the alphabet, so you get your 33. So there's some symbolism. They always mark their territory and their hoaxes with things like that. So I'm always looking for stuff like that. That's a pretty good clue. There's there where that one picture is from. Right here. That thing's even still there. One last thing here. Right on. I mean, look at this. The smiles on their face. Come on. All staged. All this staged by any means necessary. You know, I mean, it's fear. It's put fear into people who are going to see this on TV across the country. You know, across the corporation, actually. Fear of the military, etc., etc. Causes divide. You know, if we're divided, we're easier to control. So everything's about keeping us divided. Red and red versus blue. Red versus blue is everywhere in society. Look for that. It's everywhere. Fear. Here's one more little piece. It says immediately after the shootings, 300 people reassembled in protest at the Victory Bell, which is that. And then they even tell you they staged a sit-in on the slope. Students stage. Stage. Everything's staged. They tell us. Access May 4th walking tour documentary at mayforth.kent.edu. Alright, I mean, yeah, you know, I mean, they fake this stuff. There's another stage.
Hey guys, so I thought I'd talk just a couple minutes about the deception of blindness in, you know, performers. You got Stevie Wonder. This is kind of a joke, you know, Ray Charles too, you know, same kind of joke, kind of, what I'm trying to get at is, you know, they're both smiling and laughing up at the sky, and just so happy, you know. I'm so happy, you know. All right, so what I'm getting at is that these are characters. They're roles being played in this ridiculous matrix that we're being presented with. All these images going on. But, Helen Keller, another, you know, hoax on us. Somebody can be deaf and blind. You get into Stevie Wonder with no glasses. Here he is. You got the left eye. Celebrities covering the left eye. It's all that symbolism, so. Just kind of wanted to talk about that for a second. That. What I'm throwing out there is this dude's not blind. It's part of the deception. Same with Ray Charles, you know, and there's all these other famous people that are, you know, blind. This guy even got his Brave New World Arthur, blinded and all this. As a child, he suffered through blindness for years, but eventually regained sight, some sight. So, makes you question blindness. Maybe it's reversible. not necessarily a disease, but a frequency, because people can sleep with their eyes open and not see. They wake up and that frequency changes. Sorry. But yeah, all these famous artists, look at that, like he's closing his left eye here. Right? Left eye symbolism. It's because if the left eye is covered, the right side of the brain is being used, and the right side of the brain is the creativity part and the part that uses the subconscious and imagination. So these elite know that if you're covering, blinding the left eye, you're using the right side of the brain. That's also why they had a major campaign, you know, about 100, 200 years ago to get all the new children after the most recent mud flood to use their right hand to write spells to cancel out that logical left brain. That's just a little connecting dots with left, right brain. Celebrities covering the left eye, and you know, jokers like these coming out on the scene pretending to be blind. Yeah, I mean, they're playing roles, both of these. Same thing. Alright, dudes. What's up, guys? I thought I'd talk a little bit about why the elite use actors to play multiple roles and why they fake their deaths and assume new identities. I've made a few videos about this, so I'm just gonna kind of chime in on it a little bit, and I'm gonna have a cigarette while I do it. They use Hollywood effects. It controls our perception of reality. Really, the only war being fought in this matrix we live in is our perception of things. I've made a lot of videos about perception, so this is just a kind of another like a segment that I'm touching on. just showing you guys here. In part one, kind of an example of how they are able to pull it off with Hollywood effects. And they'll use characters to fake their deaths and assume new identities. It's a money maker. It makes a ton of dough. It's also a form of black magic. A lot of our reality is presented to us. It's about controlling our perception of reality. It's black magic. You got the symbolism there. Buzz Aldrin, Ringo Starr. That's what I see. It sounds crazy, I know. But the level of deceit is insane. They want to keep the cast small. That's why all the the Hollywood elite, the actors, the most famous people that we know, politicians, all these names that are in the mainstream media and entertainment, they're popular for a reason. It's by design. Because it's a small cast of people replaying different roles. It keeps the odds of the secret of that magic trick being played on us at a minimum. So they just reuse the same people to play different roles. You always hear about actors saying, oh, I want to be a musician. A musician talking, I wish I was an actor. It's because they are. Yeah, Jimi Hendrix, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Tommy Lee Jones. List goes on and on. So here's part two. There's Marilyn Monroe holding up a flat earth map symbolism. So yeah, just keep them with that theme. Guys, you know, the elite use actors to play multiple roles. You got George Bush playing Charles Manson. Not only do they look the same, they sound the same. it's what these guys gotta do. It's like an initiation process within their class of knowledge, kind of above the people like me who are kind of trapped in their web of trying to stay afloat. Yeah, it's like a casino where the house always wins, and even when the house loses, the house still wins. You got Princess Diana, who is David Furnish is Elton John's partner, and Princess Diana and Elton John had a very close relationship, and David Furnish looks just like Princess Diana. And there's a transgender war going on. A lot of the elite also play transgender roles, as well as multiple roles within their own gender. We got Richard Pryor, Steve Harvey. Very similar comedy, very similar features, and they're both very funny, kind of in the same way. And the math adds up. You got these goofy pictures. Rush Limbaugh, Jim Morrison. Sounds crazy, but when you start to look at both of them, the golden eye, Rush Limbaugh still in the limelight. Where'd he come from? That symbolism, that 666. There you go. Stevie Ray Vaughan, Tommy Lee Jones. Another kind of like example of like Jimi Hendrix and Morgan Freeman playing multiple roles. Keep the cast small. There you got Marilyn Monroe holding up the flat earth map. Again, with the symbolism the transgender agenda going on, it's not a new thing, it's been around for centuries. Mixing up the genders, sticking out that tongue, reminds me of Miley Cyrus, that whole symbolism. Yeah. all staged. Now we're coming up on part three. I'm gonna kind of chill out and let you guys watch this part. So, in part three here, I kind of, brought back in, some of the, ways in which they are able to transform people into other people. Here's Joan Rivers. Faking her death. And reappearing a couple months later.
First of all, I'm really happy to be here because I love Montreal. It's like Paris, but you bathe. And it is just so nice to be here.
Seriously,
I cannot walk down the stairs. You go.
Can I help you here?
It's very neat. Thank you. And I worked in their coffee shop as a waitress to pay to go to all the comedy. And I you were very generous because I found out if you limp, Montrealians give you extra tips. Oh, oh.
Seriously, I cannot walk down the stairs. You go. Can I help you here?
It's very neat. Thank you.
Joan Rivers. Yeah, she faked her death. Remember, she's the one who also said that Michelle Obama was a man, right? So here's David Bowie, still alive as Jack Steven. Jack Steven was a record executive that David Bowie worked with.
Now, as I promised, we'll talk now more about David.
Blah, blah, blah. Here's an interview that Jack Steven did a couple days.
Fortress music. Yeah. Do beg your pardon, Jack.
After David Bowie, quote unquote, died.
We're going to talk about as well. It's influenced the era. And Lizzie Zita, fashion stylist, Hi. Is with. Welcome to you both. Apologies again,
no
Jack.
Problem.
I mean, but perhaps first sum up how you felt this morning when you heard this.
I was just saying earlier that so, I actually felt that part of me had died. I
mean, watch here. That's how much an look how they pixelate out his face, because that's David Bowie.
Strangely, I'm surprised. I sort of lived through John Lennon's death, Elvis's death, and sadly, this one's affected me more than any.
In prosthetics, a couple days after he faked his death, out there doing this interview, bragging about himself.
Fashion, whether it was film, whether it was poetry, whether it was live work, where he was very theatrical. You know, I mean, his vocal influence, a lot of people don't.
And they keep pixeling out his face. Nobody, no pixelation anywhere else.
He Just finally then, Jack.
And then listen to her. She says, has this all been planned? Has this all been planned?
But I don't think he'll ever be forgotten.
What to do? And a couple more here. Kurt Cobain. Rivers Camille. Weezer. Nirvana and Weezer. Yeah, it's the same dude. You know, they always fake their death. It's either like 23 or 33. It's always in the numbers. Then you got Prince. He faked his death too. And he's Tyka Nelson, which is his sister, who has been this kind of like anomaly, like kind of like weird character that really hasn't been there, but kind of has. It's always just been him playing her. Because they pre-plan these death hoaxes. They plan them years in advance. They know they're going to do this. They set it up years in advance. So they set up plants like this. It's a like a long-term magic trick they're doing. It's all for gain, power, money. So yeah, dudes, I got a few more of these I'm gonna make and I'll move on from this, but yeah, it's another level of deception that I wanted to touch on, and yeah, man. Thank you.
Distinguished guests, and men and women of the finest military in the world. Most of all, Admiral Mullen, Deborah, Michael, and I also want to acknowledge your son Jack, who's deployed today.
And do you think that the country will see the United States will see the first gay president or the first woman president?
We already have it with Obama, so let's just calm down.
Got it.
You know Michelle is a trans.
I'm sorry, she's a what?
A transgender. We all.
Michael and I also want to acknowledge your son Jack, who's deployed today. Michael and I also want to acknowledge your son Jack, who's deployed today.
Very immersive scenarios which bring all of the tricks of filmmaking and theater and the magic of being able to create a moment where people go, whoa, is this real or is it not real? Is this make-believe or what? We call it the WTF moment, and that's
1970, when the cornerstone is laid in 1932, Chief Justice Charles Evan Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality. Why doesn't he say equality? Because their equal justice under law is no more our equal justice under law than their all persons are every person that we think of today.
But when you were a little girl growing up in Akron, Ohio, did you say, gee, I'd like to be an astronaut someday?
No, I really didn't think about it until right about 4 years ago when NASA announced that they were looking for astronauts who would be engineers and scientists on the space shuttle, and it was accidental that I heard about it, and I just took a chance and applied.
Justice Charles Evan Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
The resentment or a little bit of male chauvinism that was demonstrated to you. This is a very male kind of fighter pilot world that you were entering.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I think everybody leaned over backwards to make sure that we were treated as equals right from the beginning.
Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Are there discussions in Houston about what happens when men and women go into space for the first time together?
There's not discussions among us.
Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I think everybody leaned over backwards to make sure that we were treated as equals.
Word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
So the 25th space shuttle mission is now on the way after more delays than NASA cares to count. This morning it looked as though they were not going to be able to get off.
1 minute 15 seconds, velocity 2900 feet per second, altitude 9 nautical miles, downrange distance 7 nautical miles.
Looks like a couple of the solid rocket boosters blew away from the side of the shuttle in an explosion.
Flight controllers here looking very carefully at the situation. Obviously a major malfunction.
There's not discussions among us.
Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I think everybody leaned over backwards to make sure that we were treated as equals.
Word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Stockholm Syndrome is generally defined as the occurrence where hostages form emotional attachments to their captors and or begin to feel sympathy for them. Criminologist and psychiatrist Nils Bejerot first coined the term Stockholm Syndrome in 1973. That year, four people were held hostage during a bank robbery in Stockholm, Sweden. Yet, upon being released, the hostages didn't show any anger towards their captor. Instead, they defended him and even refused to testify against him in court. Since then, Stockholm Syndrome has been spotted in various situations, not just hostages and kidnappings. It has been recorded in victims of sexual abuse, human trafficking, discrimination, terror, and political and religious oppression as well.
One of the reasons why the psychology was quite so important was to enable our actors to provide authentic and very faithful stress behaviours. What we were hearing from many of the clients that we were working with was that they can get quite a lot of information from the PowerPoint, they can get it from our experts, they can get even from the policies that the consultants can draw up for them. What we were hearing was that they needed a way of embedding that information.
So you can be with your friends.
So we brought in psychologically prepared actors who could give them more or less exactly what they were going to go through in the situations that we were talking about. So the psychologist would brief every single actor on what their responses would be, what they were likely to do in various branching possibilities. So it depends how your operative reacts. If your operative goes one way, then the actor will come back at you with whatever it was the actual person in the situation would do. This provides invaluable embedding of your learning. When you come across it in a real life situation, you're not going back to which page on the manual was at, where am I at in the policy. You've done it. We're doing some training with people who work for a drug company who are being trained in how to deal with emergency situations, and they found this great pile up on the motorway and we're all bleeding and screaming. They have to check our medical priority and react to the emotional, psychological situations that are happening. And then at some stage, with some of us, our condition is going to deteriorate and they have to make a decision about whether to get us out of the car and off into an ambulance or whether we can be treated on the spot. One of the things that we found was that if you adequately brief, if you expertly brief a highly skilled actor, you will get a totally different feedback in your training. Someone who has the capacity to train as well as act, someone who has the capacity to understand the stress behaviours, to understand exactly what's going on psychologically in the situation, is going to be a vital part of your training process.
It was an accident, a stupid accident. He was using a mobile next to 4,000 litres of aviation fuel.
We started looking into the possibility of perfecting and refining a kind of scenario-based offering that would allow people to very quickly have their insights moved and affected.
Sorry to butt in, we've had a development here.
We put together a team of over 200 actors that have all been trained by our psychologist, Katie Babylon, and we're able to offer very immersive scenarios which bring all of the tricks of filmmaking and theatre and the magic of being able to create a moment where people go, whoa, is this real or is it not real? Is this make-believe or what? We call it the WTF moment, and that's what we're looking for in the learners.
So the psychologist would brief every single actor on what their responses would be, what they were likely to do in various branching possibilities. So it depends how your operative reacts. If your operative goes one way, then the actor will come back at you with whatever it was the actual person in the situation would do. This provides invaluable embedding of your learning. When you come across it in a real life situation, you're not going back to which page on the manual was at, where am I at in the policy. You've done it.
Justice Charles Evan Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
The resentment or a little bit of male chauvinism that was demonstrated to you. That's a very male kind of fighter pilot world that you're entering.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I think everybody leaned over backwards to make sure that we were treated as equals right from the beginning.
Is there
Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Are there discussions in Houston about what happens when men and women go into space for the first time together?
There's not discussions among us.
Hughes uses the word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Not at all. As a matter of fact, I think everybody leaned over backwards to make sure that we were treated as equals.
The word liberty dozens of times in his talk and never says the word equality.
Their insights moved and affected.
Sorry to butt in, we've had a development here.
We put together a team of over 200 actors that have been trained by our psychologist, Kate Babylon, and we're able to offer very immersive scenarios which bring all of the tricks of filmmaking and theatre and the magic of being able to create a moment where people go, whoa, is this real or is it not real? Is this make-believe or what? We call it the WTF moment, and that's what we're looking for.
Vampire Bible scriptures. Proverbs 30:14. There is a generation whose teeth are as swords and their jaw teeth as knives, to devour the poor from off the earth and the needy from among men. Leviticus 17:10. And whatsoever man there be of the house of Israel, or of the strangers that swarm among you, that eateth any manner of blood, I will even set my face against that soul that eateth blood, and will cut him off from among his people. Revelation 16:6. For they have shed the blood of saints and prophets, and thou hast given them blood to drink, for they are worthy. Joel 1:6. For a nation is come up upon my land strong and without number, whose teeth are the teeth of a lion, and he hath the cheek teeth of a great lion. Chronicles 11:19. And said my God, forbid it me that I should do this thing. Shall I drink the blood of these men that have put their lives in jeopardy? For the jeopardy of the lies that they brought it. Therefore he would not drink it. These things did these three mightiest. Deuteronomy 12:23. Only be sure that thou eat not the blood, for the blood is the life, and thou mayest not eat the life with the flesh. Revelation 17:6. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. Acts 15:28.
for it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. Ephesians 6:12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Micah 7:2, the good man is perished out of the earth, and there is none upright among men. They all lie in wait for blood. They hunt every man his brother with a net. Revelation 9:8, and they had hair as the hair of a woman, and their teeth were as of lions. Proverbs 30:11, there is a generation that crushes their father and doth not bless their mother. Deuteronomy 32:17, they sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not.